Looks like we're going to go a little long today. Is that okay? Well, long is kind of relative when you talk to our Solomon Islander friends. So how long do you guys worship for on a Sunday? What's your first service go for on a Sunday? 4 or 5 hours. Did you catch that? 4 or 5 hours. So long is relative, isn't it? I know we've all got lots of things that we're planning on doing, but long is relative. And if it's good, it doesn't matter, does it? Doesn't matter if it's good. Okay, well, I want to share a message with you this morning that's based on our Absolute Surrender series that I've called More Than Words. And it springboards out of our Acts passage. And in Acts, we hear from Peter and James and Paul. And there's one of the voices missing, because you always hear about Peter, James, and John. So we're going to hear from John as well. So we're springboarding from Acts into 1 John chapter 5 just shortly. But I just want to tell you, so this gives you a little bit of context for our passage this morning, because yesterday was a bit of a blur. Friday, I had a really unique opportunity. I was inducting some of our Solomon Islander friends into Australian culture. See, Paul has never been to Australia before at all, had you, Paul? No, that's right. Andrew had been some years ago. And so everything about Australia, I asked, oh, what have you seen of Australia? They said, well, the road from the airport. And it was night. So they actually didn't see much at all, because, I don't know, the road from the airport to Mapleton, there's not many things to see, really. Oh, Aussie World. You go past Aussie World. But anyway, so I thought, well, I'm going to find out about these guys. I want to be very careful, because I don't want to offend them. When you hear that their services go for 4 hours, we wouldn't want to say, oh, it was such a long service this morning. It went for almost 2 hours. That would be offensive, wouldn't it? You know, so don't say that. Just in case. Okay. But so I had to think very carefully about, I asked lots of questions and found out about their culture and all kinds of things. Poor Andrew was tired by the end of the conversation, because he's like, oh, stop asking me questions. We got about halfway and I thought, well, I can induct them into a really important part of Australian culture, McDonald's. Yeah? You're not Australian if you haven't eaten a Big Mac, right? Actually, that's probably American. But anyway, it's certainly a part of our Australian culture, maybe not a healthy part of our Australian culture. But anyway, so I took them to McDonald's and bought them a Big Mac. They weren't exactly sure what to do with it, because, you know, it comes in all this packaging stuff. And so anyway, we inducted them into the Australian culture of the Big Mac. And that was only because there was no KFC present. Okay? If there was a KFC present, I probably would have inducted them into the Australian food of KFC, which is not an Australian food at all. And it wouldn't have helped in their Australian learning at all. But anyway, that's just part of our culture. But why do I tell you that? Well, because I was trying to be very careful about, well, if I take them to McDonald's, is there going to be an issue? Like, what do you guys eat? Do you eat meat, for instance? You know, when you're meeting people from an island culture, is meat part of it? So I found out, yes, they eat fish and they eat meat. They get tuna in a can, comes to the island, and they can buy tuna once every now and then. So I wanted to find out. And why do I say that? Well, because our passage today has some interesting aspects to it to do with, well, what do we do so that we don't offend another culture? I've entitled this sermon More Than Words, but it's actually really about absolute surrender. And you can just imagine Jesus sitting on a chair with one of our modern Gen Xers saying, no, I really do want to, I want you to follow me. It's not on Twitter or Facebook. I literally want you to follow me. Jesus calls us into a life of following. So on that note, let's go to the book of Acts chapter 15, and we'll continue in our series as we encounter God and discover something of what it means to enter into absolute surrender. A little bit of context first. I'm going to take you back to chapter 15, verse 1 first, which says, certain people came down from Judea to Antioch and were teaching the believers, unless you are circumcised according to the custom taught by Moses, you cannot be saved. There was an issue. an issue of obeying the law. And if you didn't obey the law through circumcision, and that means something, doesn't it, being circumcised? If you didn't obey the law through that, there was a group of Pharisaical Christians who were saying, if you didn't do that, you could not be saved. And Pastor Matt preached on this last Sunday night, so I'm not going to actually preach on that again, but I'm just going to just let you know that's the context there. And the thing is, Paul and Barnabas sharply disagree with this. And on their crusade to solve this problem, they end up in Jerusalem at the council, which we heard about last week. Pastor Matt talked about it being a boxing match of trading blows. The Pharisees come out first and they say their argument about you must obey the law of Moses and you must be circumcised or you cannot be saved. And then Paul and Peter and James wade in, and the Holy Spirit finally has his say. And he makes it clear in a letter that was to be written to the church in Antioch. That's kind of where we come from. Letters are pretty exciting things, actually. Do you like it, receiving a letter? These days, a real letter in the real post, in a real envelope, is like kind of cool. Because we don't get them much anymore, do we, with our emails? But there was a letter to be written, and that's what we are going to encounter now in Acts 15. Let's read from verses 19 through to 35. So this is James's judgment based on the intervention and teaching of the Holy Spirit directly to them. He says, it's my judgment, therefore, that we should not make it difficult for the Gentiles who are turning to God. Instead, we should write to them, telling them to abstain from food polluted by idols, from sexual immorality, from the meat of strangled animals, and from blood. For the law of Moses has been preached in every city from the earliest of times, and it is read in the synagogues on every Sabbath. Verse 22 continues, then the apostles and the elders with the whole church decided to choose some of their own men and send them to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. They chose Judas, called Barsabbas, and Silas, men who were leaders among the believers. And with them they sent the following letter. Here it is. The apostles and elders, your brothers, to the Gentile believers in Antioch, Syria, and Cilicia, greetings. We've heard that some went out from us without authorization and disturbed you, troubling your minds by what they said. So we all agreed to choose some men and send them to you with our dear brothers, Barnabas and Paul, men who have risked their lives for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, we're sending Judas and Silas to confirm by word of mouth what we're writing. It seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us not to burden you with anything beyond the following requirements. You are to abstain from food sacrificed to idols, from blood, from the meat of strangled animals, and from sexual immorality. You will do well if you avoid these things. Farewell. And then in verse 30, it finalizes, so the men were sent off and went down to Antioch, where they gathered the church together and delivered the letter. The people read it and were glad for its encouraging message. Judas and Silas, who themselves were prophets, said much to encourage and strengthen the believers. After spending some time there, they were sent off by the believers with the blessing of peace to return to those who had sent them. But Paul and Barnabas remained in Antioch, where they and many others taught and preached the word of God. This is the narrative from which I want to jump this morning. And the reason I don't want to stay here is because, as I said, Pastor Matt preached on pretty much the same words last Sunday night, but also because it actually asks an absolute surrender question of all of us this morning. And so I want us to ask that absolute surrender question. It stimulates a line of thinking we need to consider. What is the place of law or God's commands in the life of a believer? What is the place of Jesus' commands? Jesus is saying, follow me. What do we follow? Something? We do, don't we? We follow something. So what is the place of God's commands in the lives of a believer? Because these guys wrote this letter, they said, to relieve a burden. We don't wish to burden you with anything more than this. And they gave the three things. Refrain from sexual immorality, they said. Refrain from eating the meat sacrificed to idols, and refrain from eating meat that's been strangled to kill it. That was what they asked them to do. So is it all good then? We right then? We know what we've got to do. We have to restrain from sexual immorality. Well, we know that's a very strong teaching of the church, right? So no blood from strangled meat this week, folks. Were you planning on that one? No, because that's not our issue, is it? We weren't planning on engaging in blood from strangled meat. And no eating food sacrificed to idols this week. This is what God requires of us, right? No. It is. It's taught, right? There's a truth here. But is that all there is to this passage? Is that all there is to following Jesus? Just what these people were asked? No, why were they being asked this? There was an issue being addressed. And they were being asked this as a response to the grace of God in the issue that was being addressed. So the question I ask is, what, therefore, is the place of rules or commands or teachings in the Christian walk? Because we're about to get to absolute surrender as a series, and there's a great danger that we could start to emphasize a faith of works, all the things we've got to do. And guess what that's akin to? That's akin to bearing a burden. See, you and me, we actually can have a problem. We don't typically have a problem theologically. We have a problem practically speaking. We can agree with what God's Word says in our mind about this, but practically our victory can be robbed when we sin. Here's what we can do. Something like this. You know, you or I, probably more you than me, because I'm a good, godly, holy man, I wouldn't sin, right? You get it. I do, right? Just in case you want, I do. Okay, I sin. Not any bad sins or anything. I do. Just like you, okay? But here's what happens when I sin. An accuser comes and stands on my shoulder and says, and you call yourself a Christian. What are you going to do now? You've sinned. It's all over. God doesn't love you anymore. And I'm like, no. I know what I'm supposed to do. I'm going to confess my sin and I'm going to be like, as if he's going to forgive you now. How many times have you committed that same sin? And how many times have you asked for forgiveness for that same sin? No. I know that God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. If we confess our sins, I know that God forgives us of our sins. And then you're going to try and get up in front of a congregation and preach to them. Yeah, right. As if you are a good standing, you know, moral example of what godliness is to these people. We can end up in a place of great defeat as a result of the impact of sin in our lives. Now, I have to assume, if I'm being honest, that happens to me. Happened last night. I was wondering, what possible right do I have to come and stand in front of you, my brothers and sisters in Christ? Because I'm not a perfect man. The accuser comes and he robs us of our victory. He robs us of the freedom that we have in Christ, and we get stuck in a you're no good, sin, confess, sin, confess, sin, confess kind of cycle. See, the problem, practically speaking, is that we have linked salvation to obedience, and we've linked forgiveness to obedience. But I want to suggest to you this morning from God's Word that surrender to Him is not a burden. It's not a burden. We obey God to really live. God wants us to understand that salvation is not a product of obedience for a good reason, so that obeying is not a burden, but rather a way to really live. So we've heard from Peter and James, but how about John? Jump over to 1 John chapter 5. I want to read to you from 1 John chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. says this: everyone who believes that Jesus is the Messiah has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father also loves the one born of him. This is how we know that we love God's children, when we love God and obey his commands. For this is what love for God is, to keep his commands. Now, his commands are not a burden, because whatever has been born of God conquers the world. This is the victory that has conquered the world, our faith. And who is the one who conquers the world but the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Now, I have to point out something here. There are commands. That letter in Acts 15 was not doing away with Christ's commands. The problem was that the people had come and taught them that they were only able to be saved by keeping those commands. There are commands. In Matthew 28, verse 18 to 20, the Great Commission, Jesus says, go into all the world, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I have commanded. So Jesus, this is the same Jesus who says, come to me, all ye who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. This is the same Jesus who says, cast your cares upon me, for I care for you. Same Jesus says, obey my commands. 1 John chapter 5, verse 3, we just read it, says, in fact, this is love for God, to keep his commands. In John 8, verse 31 and 32, Jesus, the good shepherd, says this: if you hold to my teachings, you are my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Let's go to an Old Testament witness for a second in the book of Jeremiah. See if I can find Jeremiah in my new Bible. In Jeremiah 7, breaking in some new pages, sorry folks. In Jeremiah 7, verse 23, we read this: but I gave them this command, obey me, and I will be your God, and you will be my people. Walk in obedience to all I command you, that it may go well with you. Now, there's a hint in that passage as to what the command's role is in the lives of those who follow God. And I'm going to get to the hint in a moment. But obedience is not unto salvation, but unto good. In John 10:10, Jesus says, I have come that you may have life and have it to the full, with abundance. What is that abundant life that Christ has promised the believers? Obedience is not unto salvation, but it's unto good. So I want to use a military example for a second. The military has a command structure, and they have a chain of command, and you have to follow the chain of command. But that whole organization, does it exist for no reason? Is it just because we like chains of command that the military exists in the way that it does? No, it has a purpose, does it not? To defend the country and to offend the country when we are at times of war, sometimes to keep the peace as well. But the command structure does not exist for its own purpose. It exists to make sure that the purpose of defending and offending the country can take place. And there is a purpose for God's law, God's commands, God's teachings in our lives. But there are also three modern heresies that are addressed. There are two to the modern church and one perhaps to the world. And I want to start with the first one, which is probably not the one that we believe so much. We don't get tempted with this one, because evangelical Christians often, we're very solid on, we are saved by grace through faith. But there are those in the world today, most of the people that you witness to, if you ever have a conversation with someone who is kind of got some idea of what churches believe. They think we believe that you're saved by doing good. That's what they think. You're saved by doing good. Now, in 1 John chapter 5, verse 1, we read, "Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves his child as well." That one verse alone tells us that it's based on belief that Jesus is the Christ that makes us born of God. In verse 5, we read the same thing, the same kind of principle. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Now, when you sit down and talk to someone out in the world and they say, well, you know, my good will outweigh my bad and it will all be good. And you're like, no. What saves us? We're saved by grace through faith. That was the point of the letter, and it's the point of John 1 John 5, verse 1. There's a second heresy, though, that is probably a little bit more prevalent in terms of absolute surrender and keeping the commands. And it's this one. Well, we're saved by grace, but we're sustained by keeping the commands, by doing good. We're sustained by doing the good things that God has asked of us. In chapter 5, verse 4, we read this. For everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. So John is pointing out that we're not just saved by grace, but we overcome by grace. We have victory by grace. It is by grace that we conquer the world, and it's God's grace. Okay, so we're not saved by doing good, and we're not sustained by doing good. The third heresy is, how I live doesn't matter then. Is that right? If we're not saved by doing good, and we're not sustained or kept by doing good, I don't need to do good, right? That's right. How I live does matter. Because the thing is, folks, salvation isn't all there is. Is it pivotal? Yes. Is it necessary? Yes. Does every person on the planet need it? Yes. But is it all there is? What are we saved unto? Are we not saved unto the kingdom of God? Jeremiah 7:23 said that we were given these commands that it might go well for you. Think about that for a second. John 10:10, I have come that you may have life and have it to abundance, to the full. People make that say, that means, or prosperity and good things. No. The full life that God has promised us is the life in his kingdom under his rule and reign the way it was supposed to be. Folks, obeying the commands is for a purpose. What is the purpose is the question. What is the purpose? It's to have the good life that God intended. See, our faith is more than words. It's a life of actions built on something. Responding to something, is it not? We've just heard we were saved by grace, we're sustained by grace, so live by grace. But the way we live by grace is to follow God's ways. Let me use a conservation example for a second. Let's imagine I decide I'm going to become a conservationist. So I go down to the local council and I pick up the pamphlets that they've got on the conservation groups that are in my society, and I read through all the conservation groups and I find out that there's a really good one on cleaning up Australia. And so I think, yes, that's a great idea. And then I start researching all the people who are dumping waste and ruining our country and making a mess of the country. And I find out who all those people are. And I go along to a meeting where they're going to organise to clean up Australia. And I go to the meeting, yes, that's a great idea. We should definitely do that. Conservation's so important. We need to do that. Have I yet been a conservationist? No. Conservationist is someone who actually does the thing, isn't it? Someone who conserves, someone who actually goes and picks up the rubbish. That shows with more than words that I'm a conservationist. And I think that God has given us the commands as a way to really live. Let me put it another way. Do you ever feel bad when you've obeyed God? Anyone ever feel bad? Oh, I'm so angry I didn't sin today. Well, you probably couldn't say that because I doubt that you got through a day that you didn't sin. But I'm so angry that I didn't sin today. No, do you ever feel bad about not sinning? No, we don't feel bad about not sinning. We only feel bad when we sin. See, in John 1, he says, the commands of God are not burdensome. So how does that work? How can it be that we have to obey these commands, but they're not a burden? Well, it's understanding. One, we're not saved by them. And two, we're not sustained by them. What they are is a way to really live in God's kingdom. See, folks, they're not a burden because burdens are Christ's business. In Matthew chapter 11, we read of Jesus' interaction with some of the Pharisees. And he says this, Matthew 11:28. He says, I've said the wrong one. Matthew 28 is the fact that the burdens are Jesus' business. He says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. In 1 Peter 5:7, we read, cast your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Folks, it's not the commands that are the burden, is it? The commands aren't a burden, it's the sin. The sin that is the real cause of our burden. Psalm 38, a beautiful psalm, but the writer deals with this issue. In Psalm 38, verse 4, we read this. My guilt has overwhelmed me like a burden too heavy to bear. Folks, it's our sin that is the burden. And guess what's happened to that burden at the cross? It's been removed. And when we do sin, it's a burden that's shared, not made heavier. Here's that Matthew passage. It's Matthew 23. Matthew 23, verse 4 says of the Pharisees, they tie up heavy, cumbersome loads and put them on other people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. Yet in Galatians 6, we read what we're really supposed to be doing. We're supposed to bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. Christ is the one who takes our burden. So if obedience and absolute surrender isn't about salvation, neither is it about sustaining our Christian walk, what is it? It's a way to really live, in God's kingdom. And we read in 1 John 5, again, it's a way we say, I love you, back to God. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. Everyone who loves the Father loves his child as well. This is how we know we love the children of God, by loving God and carrying out his commands. Listen, in fact, this is love for God, to keep his commands. Could it be any stronger? This is love for God, to keep his commands. It's how we say we love you, back to God, to live the way he intended for us always to live. Look, who's ever better off for going and committing adultery? Who's ever better off for going and stealing or lying or coveting your neighbor's possessions? Who's better off for those things? We're not better off. They're not a way to live. Living in God's commands is a way to really live the way that God intended. And it's the way that we say, I love you, back to God. Romans 12, 1 and 2. What does it say? I urge you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. And this is your spiritual act of worship. Do not be conformed any longer to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The really important word is, I urge you, therefore, brothers and sisters. Therefore what? Therefore, because of the great salvation and sustaining of God that He has given us, this great gift that we call salvation, because of that, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. Obey my commands. Follow my ways. Live in the kingdom of God under His rule and His reign. It's not a burden. It's a way to really live, and it's a way to say, I love you. I want to finish with this song that I'm going to play on the screen in just a moment. And the song is not by a Christian group. It's a secular group that sang this song, but they really nailed this idea. See, our faith is supposed to be more than words. Living under God's rule and reign, living following Christ's commands in absolute surrender is our response. It says, I love you, God, with more than words. Have a listen to the words of this song. Glad the video, the music still played. I'm sorry that the video didn't work the way that I hoped. But more than words to say I love you. Obeying the commands of Christ, following in absolute surrender, that's our heart response that says, I love you, God. John said as much when he said, and this is love for God, to keep His commands. So over this term, we're going to rediscover absolute surrender to Christ. But let's let it be an obedience that's not based on slavish duty, trying to impress God or sustain our salvation or earn something from God, but rather out of a love response of a grateful heart that's been set free, living in line with God's best plans for us. That's what they're for. To live in line with God's best plans for us. Why not surrender to God? Jesus' burden is light, and his way is a way to really live. Will you commit to obeying because of your love for Christ, for his tremendous gift? God's word promises, as we read, that this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. We don't have victory because of our success. We don't have victory because of our ability to do good. We don't have victory because of our strong-willed ability to resist sin. That is not the place that our victory is found. Our victory is found in Christ. What does he say? For everyone who is born of God overcomes the world. Everyone who is born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? The one who believes in the Son of God. Folks, when we realize this, instead of a burden, obedience becomes a joy, a way to really live. Jesus' burden is light. Why don't you surrender to him? Let's pray. Lord, your word is powerful and rich, and even as we've come before it this morning, there's so much more that is yet to be said. And as we continue in this series of absolute surrender, Father, I pray that our hearts might be open to respond to you in love because of your great gift. We're so thankful. We're thankful for our salvation. We're thankful for our sustaining life in you. And we're thankful that you didn't just give us a way to struggle around through life and just kind of grope from place to place, but you gave us a way to really live that reflects the way you intended it to be. Lord, may we really devote ourselves in absolute surrender to obeying and following and walking with you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.